I'm Liz Yocum from the Chesapeake Bay Foundation, and you caught me at my favorite spot. These trees not only provide a great place to hang, but they also do so much for the environment. Can you think of some environmental benefits of trees? Perfect. You might have thought of increased oxygen, decreased carbon dioxide and greenhouse gases, or provide habitat for a variety of animals. And you're absolutely right. Today, we're going to also learn about how trees can be a part of something called a riparian buffer. We're going to learn about how riparian buffers can impact the health of the stream and ultimately the Chesapeake Bay.
Today, we will explore three questions. What is a riparian buffer? Why are they important? And how do riparian buffers impact the health of the Chesapeake Bay and its watersheds? Let's check it out.
Here I am in a stream that has a riparian buffer. A riparian buffer is the strip of vegetation, the trees and the plants alongside a stream that provide shade and protection. Now that we know what a riparian buffer is, let's think about why does a stream need shade and what does a stream need protection from?
As you watch this video, you might see some water striders skidding across the surface of the water. Now I want you to imagine yourself in the middle of a field on a hot summer day. The sun is beating down on you. How does it feel? Not so good, right? You might feel sticky and sweaty and irritable, and all you want to do is find some shade. Well, just like you, many aquatic insects and animals like the cooler temperatures. In fact, these cooler temperatures are optimal for their life cycles. So, planting trees along the streams in a riparian buffer provides the shade that is necessary to keep those stream temperatures cooler. In fact, cooler stream temperatures help with dissolved oxygen. Oxygen is necessary for the aquatic life to live. Here I am in the stream looking for macroinvertebrates. Macroinvertebrates can help us give us an idea as to the health of the stream. So we were just talking about how trees provide shade and allow the stream to stay at optimal temperatures and don't have such drastic swings in temperatures. Well, trees also provide sticks and leaves in the stream that can become habitat for these macroinvertebrates. So to find macroinvertebrates, you can lift up rocks and look to see what might be living on the rock. Here is a larva of some kind of creature. We'll look at them a little closer and identify in a second. So we find the larva of aquatic insects. See if there's anything else on this rock. Some aquatic insects, like the caddisfly, will actually use sticks to make little homes until it's time for them to go into the next stage of its life cycle. So, I don't see any other creatures moving on this rock. Ooh, this might be a little one. That looks like maybe a leech. I'll put it in the bin here. All right. Oh, look, another larva. So we'll put that in my ice cube tray here. It's keeping them alive with some water. Let's see if we can find some more macroinvertebrates. I'll look at this rock. We'll look to see if there's anything moving. Oh, here's a little guy. Oh, I can't get him. Put him in my water, keep him safe. Oh, there's lots of leeches on this rock. So, in a second, we'll look at a chart to identify these macroinvertebrates and see if they can tell us a little bit about the stream health. So we now have a bunch of macroinvertebrates. Let's take a second to identify them. So this guy who seems to be crawling out, let's identify him first. And it looks like he is a crane fly larva. Then if we look at this guy in the corner here, he's got antenna and legs coming off the side. It looks very much like the isopod or the aquatic sow bug. Then if we look at this friend here, we notice that it has three tails and then it has these feathery gills on the side. So if I use my chart, I see that if it has three tails, it might be a mayfly nymph or a damselfly nymph. However, I notice that the damselfly nymph does not have those feathery gills on the side. So that means this friend here is a mayfly nymph. Look, where else do we have? Oh, we have this guy crawling up the side there. He has like a triangular shaped head. And so that means I have a planaria or a flatworm. So awesome that we found all these macroinvertebrates living in our stream. It's now time to return the aquatic insects, the macroinvertebrates, to the stream because they are really important to the stream's ecosystem. One, they provide food for other aquatic organisms, and also they can be indicators to us on the health of the stream. Depending on which macroinvertebrates are there, or how many are there, we can decide if the stream is healthy or is in need of repair. Remember, if the stream is in need of repair, there are things that we can do to help it, like planting a riparian buffer. Remember, the riparian buffer is trees or plants that are planted along the stream that help protect or shade the stream. So remember, if we shade the stream, that we are helping the stream regulate its temperatures, which provides ideal environment for these aquatic insects and other organisms to live and complete their life cycles. Also, remember those trees provide the leaves and the sticks that become habitat and food for these macroinvertebrates. I want you to think back to our definition of a riparian buffer. Remember, we said a riparian buffer is the strip of vegetation, the trees and the plants along a stream that help provide shade and protection. We're now going to look at what does a stream need protection from. But first, I want you to take a look at this clip. You just watched a clip of a rain shower. Where does that rain go once it hits the land? Where does the water go once it hits your street? Once it hits your yard? Where does the water go once it hits the farmer's fields? The answer is that the water will flow and drain to a common body of water. So that land, your yard, the farmer's field, is part of a watershed, and all the water will drain to a body of water, like a stream. And so sometimes in rain events, we have too much water flowing at once, and this can cause something called erosion. Erosion occurs when water takes away parts of the land. So if you look here, this land was eroded away. This can cause problems to our waterways. When the land gets into the water, it causes sedimentation. Sedimentation can then be a problem for our aquatic life. The bits of soil and rock can then get in the gills of our macroinvertebrates or fish. Sedimentation is also a problem because it impacts the clarity of the water. We call this turbidity. So if the water is not clear, the sunlight cannot get to the aquatic plants, which aquatic plants are important food sources for many aquatic organisms. So it is really important that we plant trees to protect our stream banks. Those trees have deep roots that hold the soil in place and prevent erosion occurring. So remember, we need to have those riparian buffers in place
to provide protection to our stream banks.
So here we are at our last stop of the Riparian Buffer tour, and we're going to check out this tree's root system. So remember how we were talking about how roots help hold the soil in place and prevent erosion? Well, these roots also work as a filtration system. So when it rains and the water hits the land and flows to that stream, it picks up a lot of stuff along the way. For instance, it could pick up leftover gas or oil that's left on our streets. It could pick up the herbicides and insecticides that people spray on their lawns. It could pick up the animal waste or the fertilizer that are on farms. And all that stuff can then end up in our water. And that can cause major problems for the aquatic life. It can cause fish kills, it can cause algae blooms, and all of these things decrease the health of our stream. And so it's important that we have riparian buffers because they act as a filter and they can limit the number of contaminants that are getting into our waterways.
Thanks for hanging out with me today. I hope you enjoyed learning about riparian buffers. We just have one more question to answer, and that is, how do riparian buffers impact the health of the Chesapeake Bay? Some of you may have already figured it out. Your local waterway may be connected to the Chesapeake Bay, depending where you live. So that stream behind your house, or that creek that runs by your school, or that stream that's in your neighborhood park, that may eventually lead to the Chesapeake Bay. And so what you do locally will have an impact on the Chesapeake Bay. So for instance, if you plant that riparian buffer and you're able to decrease the sedimentation or contamination of your waterway, you will be decreasing the sedimentation and contamination of the Chesapeake Bay. If you're able to put that riparian buffer in and protect and shade your stream so that the temperatures are regulated, then you are ultimately having an impact on the temperatures of the Chesapeake Bay. And the same with if you're providing food sources and shelter for aquatic life locally, then down the line, it will impact the aquatic life of the Chesapeake Bay. So remember, you play an important role, and there are things that you can do in your own backyard to help improve the state of the Chesapeake Bay.